Thursday. What time is our program?
Then when?
Can be here at 10:15.
So let me.
What about the other people in the room?
She's also a different doctor.
Ah, okay.
Well, it was properly reflective of the ecology at this time to inspire or illuminate, and that is the reason why it had such a negative reception from not only from the audience, the immediate audience, but also from the rest of the Filipino public. So it is symptomatic of the general malaise in society today. It cannot be considered in isolation or separate and distinct from what is taking place in the country. We have a National Disaster Coordinating Council, but it's only a clearing house, and apparently, as was obvious during the entire period of the calamity, it has no resources or capability for quick response, relief, and rehabilitation. In other words, there has never been any forward basing. It is simply not fit for the functions contemplated by law for that office. There is therefore a need for a National Disaster Management Office nationwide. For, as I said, the present NDCC only serves as a clearing house, and as you yourselves saw, it could not even furnish information to the constituency. I understand that the president obtained her information during the first few days of the catastrophe from media, so it was media which responded to the crisis instead of government. There was therefore an abdication of proper governmental functions during that time. There was no information management, and there was no disaster management to speak of.
Could you comment on
the ano sabi mo, kapwisit? Kapwisit? Well, we have a constitutional provision which mandates the state shall promote and encourage non-governmental organizations, even sectoral organizations, if it will promote the interest of the public. So KBISIG is in line with the constitutional vision, but there are certain, it has not evoked any animated response at all from the Filipino people for various reasons. Number one, the sheer establishment of KBISIG is an admission in itself of a failure or a breakdown in the delivery of basic governmental services. For if this were being carried out efficiently, there would be no raison d'etre or no reason for KBISIG to exist. Isn't that so? So its mere establishment is already an admission of defeat on the part of the government. Secondly, it comes too late in the day. It comes at about 2/3 downstream of President Aquino's administration. What will KBISIG be able to accomplish in the remaining 2 years? And the last year of which will certainly be devoted to politicking for the next political exercise. So it comes as an afterthought. And then thirdly, I understand that the administration proposes to appropriate certain official funds for KBISIG. This might raise authentic constitutional issues on the validity of the executive power to appropriate funds from the National Treasury, a function which is normally reserved exclusively only for the legislative branch of government. So from the National Treasury to KBISIG, they should, even only out of ethical propriety, make an attempt to give similar disbursements to all other NGOs. Why pick on KBISIG only? So because of these three reasons, KBISIG does not seem to have elicited the response that administration hoped for. It we'll have to say, therefore, that as a creature, it is stillborn. It is an action, it stands for movement for responsible public service. It is a nationwide citizens movement for good government. And it is not individual specific. It is agency specific. That is to say, I did not establish Uber so that I could prosecute against national order and the public service. Is properly a function of the ombudsman. You know, if you have any complaint against any government agency for non-feasance, malfeasance, or misfeasance, then you file it with the ombudsman. Or if there is a need for further investigation, then that is a law enforcement function and it properly falls with the NDI. So we do not seek to supplant, much less to replace, to at least all functions of already existing government offices. What we want to do is, I think, unique in the sense that it has not yet been confronted or addressed by any major organization in the country. What we need to do is to expose the anatomy of graft. That's to say, when we Filipinos talk of graft and corruption, this is one of our peculiar avocations at present. Everyone always talks of graft and corruption. We want to define our terms. We want to expose to public scrutiny the specific mechanics, the specific procedures or programs by which money is deliberately and diabolically by corrupt officials and diverted from official use. So I will make an attempt to relate tri-media how graft is actually committed in our country. And for every graft problem that I am able to expose, I hope to propose at least one solution. So I hope to publish an anti-graft manual, How to Fight Graft. I will enumerate in sequential order the graft problems that I encountered when I was fighting graft in CIT and in the TAR. And for every graft problem, I will explain what I did in CIT and the relative level of success that we reached and other solutions that the public might want to input to me and my staff. And we hope to do this not only in print through our manual, but also by radio and TV spots. So, you know, I have no direct access to the documents or to the evidence involved. And as a trial judge, I was educated here in the College of Law, as well as by 5 years experience in Quezon City Hall, that there is always a hazard when a person seeks to sit on judgment on a case that I can only access to secondhand. You know, all I know of the case is what I read in the papers. So I must say that there appears to be irregularity. There is apparently no question that there was irregularity or there was at least controversy attendant to the scandal, but I cannot identify who was responsible for it simply because I don't have direct personal access to the evidence. It's very hard to convict secondhand or long distance.
So do you comment on the definition for a death moratorium?
Yes, in fact, that will be the burden of my speech. So maybe it's better to wait for my speech. But I am opposed to it. I am opposed to a unilateral debt moratorium because it negatives everything that I learned in international law here in the college as well as when I specialize in international law abroad. So it simply goes against the grain of our legal system. The solution is not a unilateral debt moratorium. Do you understand what is a unilateral debt moratorium? It's for the debtor to tell the creditor, I refuse to pay my debts. To our states and agencies and say, in view of the recent earthquake, and we don't have to pummel you on the head with data and statistics about how ruinous it was for our country, which is poor as it was, and then we get hit. I am in favor of a debt moratorium. I am against unilateral moratorium, in favor of bilateral or negotiated moratorium. Because this is the way it's done in international relations. It's very fancy, and maybe it's even fashionable or maybe even glamorous or expedient to say, let's just stop paying our creditors. But it's not going to work out well for our country in the long run, even in the medium run. In the short run, maybe, because then we get money. But we have, as an illustrative case, I'm going to tell the law students that in law school, we are schooled to use what is called the case study technique. We study actual cases as they occurred in a chronological past. In this case, we have an illustrative instance of what happened when a country made a unilateral debt moratorium. One of the South American countries in the 1980s did this. And we're already in a position, because this took place in 1980, we're already in a position to assess whether overall it redounded to the benefit of the country or not, and it didn't, because its exports dipped, nobody wanted to import its products anymore,